the Marcos Duterte power struggle. There's no going back to UNITIM, is there?
I mean, I'm not a political expert, and I don't want to claim that I've been talking to people when I'm not. But when your partnership is based on mutual self-interest rather than mutual goals or ideology or programs, well, when the mutual self-interest is no longer mutual, what do you expect?
Stevie, the Duterte is going against Marcos, who is in power right now. Was that a political suicide for Sara Duterte, who many people are expecting to run for the highest post in the land in 2028? I mean, we have 2025 first next year, and then there's 2028.
Well, okay, what I want to say is clearly, if they're trying to recalibrate and reassert their political base independent of somebody so that they can say, I'm factor my own, then yeah, you have to do it now. Number one. But number two is, I remember after President Ramos stepped down, he was called to Congress and Miriam Defensor Santiago was really trying to needle him and everything. And he just stayed cool. That's part of what the democracy is. You know, I mean, and then one of the things I worry about is the sense of entitlement some politicians have. I mean, you want to enter competitive democratic politics, especially Philippine style. Be ready to take the questions, be ready to take the issues, be ready to take everything, or don't participate. But you can't say these rules don't apply to me. That's my view.
All right. So from politics.
And also, to be frank, she's never had a national position until she became VP. She was frankly used to being the daughter of the mayor and the mayor.
And the daughter of the president.
Yeah. And so now she's saying, you want to step into a higher plane, then be ready for what it entails.
It's a blood sport, as they say, politics. From politics, Stevie, I want to end with something more economic. Central banks, back in the spotlight, the Federal Reserve. You know, I was looking at some files and I realized there's only one central banker that made it to Time Magazine's Person of the Year recognition in the last 25 years. Ben Bernanke, 2009. And Time Magazine at that time...
He saved
exactly.
The U.S. and most of the world from getting into, needless to say, not just a recession, which there was, but a depression.
Exactly.
And he was the right central banker at the time because his doctoral thesis was on avoiding depressions and recessions and learning the lessons from the 1929 crash. So he was actually uniquely qualified at the time.
So Stevie, has the time come? Has the time come for Jerome Powell? Is this his moment to save the world?
Well, I've read some very interesting commentary because I don't want to claim credit for what is not an original thought. And it was on Financial Times and Bloomberg and Larry Summers on Business Week. Powell has made a lot of mistakes. But why he's still doing well is because he actually has a surprising flexibility and humility to do a U-turn when it's appropriate. Like he said, inflation is transitory. When it wasn't, he raised interest rates. So, I mean, it was like literally 180. And there are other examples that are saying. And so one of the virtues of Jerome Powell is when the evidence says you're going the wrong way, he changes. And he changes quite nimbly. And so in a strange way, the markets have become rather calm because they said if he gets it wrong, he's not going to be pig-headed and stick down a wrong path. He is pragmatic enough and quick enough to pivot. Mm-hmm. And actually, that's a really great virtue.
And of course, the markets love it. The S&P 500 spiking last week, hovering near all-time highs, right?
Yeah, because after saying it's not ready, we are waiting. He says, okay, now it's ready. And I think he said that ahead of time to basically prime the market to say, relax. what you've been asking for is coming soon. I'm not going to panic and send the wrong signal by doing it ahead of cycle, but I want you to calm down to say you will be happy in September.
So is this the start of the good times? The good times
begin
to roll?
We are ready to make a cut. He didn't say how many cuts. He didn't say how deep. So, but what he's saying is at least the fear you had that I would stay put for too long or even increase again, for now is gone. But again, don't forget, he's very, very adept at pivoting.
He could pivot again. Who knows?
A major central bank governor who can pivot like him and basically leave no glass on the floor while he's pivoting.
Final question, Stevie. Many of those who are watching us now are businessmen. Some are of listed companies, others just MSMEs, entrepreneurs, you know, trying to make it. How should they view 2025? The rest of 2024 and 2025, you think better days are ahead?
Okay, there's two things. If you look at why, let's start with, why did we have to raise interest rates so much? First, to keep the world from getting into a deep recession during COVID, they basically, you had global ayuda, all right? You had basically welfare grants and special programs, child tax credit in the US, same thing in the West, and a lesser extent in the third world, all right? Now, that coupled with supply chain disruptions and pent-up demand coming back and then inability to meet it led to inflation. Now, then to counter that, you basically had to raise interest rates. Then supply chain disruption had round two when Russia invaded Ukraine, because Ukraine is a major exporter of wheat, and basically, there's also disruption for oil and natural gas. Now, we've all calmed down. We've adjusted. The West has become a little more resilient in not relying on Russian-sourced gasoline. Mm-hmm. Because don't forget, natural gas from Russia heats most of Europe during the winter. Okay? Germany and so on. It's very important. So it was not a minor thing to recalibrate to lessen your dependence on that. So, the problem is you always assume equilibrium when the assumption of equilibrium is very transitory. So, can we assume things will be good? The question is, what are you assuming behind the assumptions? I mean, let's look at a flashpoint, the Middle East. What if there becomes a broader conflict?
Mm-hmm. And on that sobering note, on that big question, Stevie, that's 4 years and 2 minutes. Thank you very much for joining us. And Never Enough Time. We'll see you next month with even more exciting stories to tackle. Thank you again. We'll see you soon.
Hope so. Thank you very much.
All right. Bye.